the Waal has covered former Soviet Union conflict zones already for 2 decades, I believe. He knows not only Georgia, Armenia, Azerbaijan inside out, but also breakaway territories. He has unique knowledge and experience, on-ground knowledge and information, I would say, which is actually definitely valuable now for someone studying conflict zones. And Archie Division is there, Dr. Division is there, former student in the US. Actually has been involved in Georgian and Brazilian dialogue for long, at least since I remember, I would say. And today we start with Tom's presentation. He recently has released his new book, Uncertain Ground, which is dedicated to specifically three conflicts. It's Northern Cyprus, Transnistria, and Abkhazia. And I have already familiarized myself with this study section of Abkhazia. Tom has followed Georgia, I have been following Tom, so to say. So I'm pretty familiar with his observation findings and opinions. I don't necessarily agree with him all the time, but of course, I don't mean that I don't find these findings at least interesting, I would say. So, Tom, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much for coming here, and thank you, Chil, and thank you all for coming. I'd like to also thank colleagues from the Swedish Embassy who are here, because this project is supported by the Foreign Ministry of Sweden. I should say it's a report which is over there. There are some copies. If you don't get a paper copy, you can read it online. But it's not been more than just a report. There have been a series of seminars and discussions in Brussels, in here in Tbilisi, in Sukhumi, also in Chisinau and Tiraspol, in Cyprus and in Kiev. So this has been not just a writing project, it's also a dialogue project, which I've, even though I've been studying these conflicts for a long time, I think I've learned quite a lot. So thank you for being here, and I'd also like to thank very much my colleagues from Go Group for organizing this event in this amazing hall. We've got a few more people in here. So what is this project about? Well, obviously it's about conflicts, but it's about the specific issue of, and here the terminology is always challenging, it's difficult. The issue of breakaway territories which are de facto states. Now the terminology is difficult. What do we mean by a de facto state? It means somewhere that exists on the map, that is self-governing, but is basically not in the international system, is not recognized. Some places don't really qualify for that. I would say that South Ossetia, for example, does not qualify to be a de facto state. It's not really self-governing in a serious way. But some places are de facto states, and I think three of them in Europe stand out to me. One is Abkhazia, the other is Transnistria, and the third is Northern Cyprus, Turkish Cyprus. I understand here in Tbilisi people will want to talk about Abkhazia in particular, and we should do that, but I think there are some interesting parallels and differences in the other cases you can see much more clearly. And so this is the checkpoint, for example, in Northern Cyprus, in Nicosia, which has been described as Europe's last divided capital. It's a very quite easy checkpoint. You cross in a few minutes, and there's this big sign saying Turkish Republic of Northern Cyprus forever. But that's a little deceptive because, in fact, when you spend time in Turkish Cyprus, you realize that this is almost the biggest slogan that you find there, that the project for independence in Turkish Cyprus is really not so popular anymore. And it's interesting to go to a de facto state where there is more enthusiasm for integration with the other side and ask why is that the case. So my major conclusion here is that within the framework of non-recognition, these places are not recognized. I don't think they deserve to be recognized internationally. Within the framework of non-recognition, I think there is a bigger space for engagement with these places, for international assistance, international interaction. And I think if done intelligently, I think this is good for people in these territories. And I think it's also good for the conflict resolution process. I think it builds bridges and lowers the temperature of conflict. So this is the kind of major theme of my report. However, of course, there are many nuances and many complications and many dilemmas in this issue. So there's a lot written about this in the academic literature, and I'm using three terms from the academic literature. First is de facto states. I understand that the word state is a little controversial, but I'm talking about a state as a self-governing entity. Tobias, I think the literature agrees that you don't have to have recognition to be a state. But recognition is obviously incredibly important. It means that you join international organizations, you're part of the international legal system. But these places are de facto states in the sense that they govern themselves. And they have governed themselves for decades, in the case of Northern Cyprus, almost 15 years. Parent states, this is the parent states in this case I'm talking about are Georgia, Moldova, and the Republic of Cyprus, is the places that have a de jure claim to these places. These are the parent states. And the patron states, also in the case of Northern Cyprus, it's Turkey, in the case of Abkhazia, and Transnistria, it is Russia, which provide crucial support for these places. So this is the Russian embassy in Sokolny, a picture I took when I was last there, just over a year ago. And this obviously, when you're in Tbilisi or Chisinau, Nicosia, this is obviously a crucial question. How much does the patron control? And I think the size of the building in Sokolny is a statement. In the Russian embassy is, I think, bigger than the presidential building in Sokolny. But I think there are genuine questions about how much they control. In the case of Abkhazia Transnistria, Russia is very much in charge of the security sector. It has troops there. Internationally speaking, this is an occupying force. However, in terms of domestic government, in terms of local government, the economy, education, health. The patron, I think, does not control so much. And I think here is where we talk about engagement. It's also interesting to compare the patron in Cyprus. Turkey as a patron and Russia as a patron. Turkey, I think, has much more of a development agenda for Cyprus than Russia does for Abkhazia. Turkey is interested spending money on the education system, on it has more of an interest in developing the region. I think Russia sees these regions much more in a geopolitical prism. This is a little joke. This is an IKEA shop in Sokolny. Clearly, it's not an IKEA, really real IKEA. They just have the sign outside. But I think this is when I spent time in these places, Abkhazia, Transnistria, Northern Cyprus. I think the important thing to say is that in people's imaginations, these are quite difficult, Irish criminal places where, when you go there nowadays, you're very struck by the normality of life there. The main thing that distinguishes it from a recognized state is a kind of absence of global brands, so no Starbucks, no McDonald's. But otherwise, life is fairly normal. There are government columns, health systems, traffic lights, traffic jams, traffic police. And I think this is an interesting aspect, is that having been in this situation for so long, people want to have a kind of the security of the state involves. They want to have state-like agency. I think we should understand that it's impossible to live without a state, or very difficult to live without a state. And so when these places say that they want independence my researchers there understand. Let's reinterpret that a little and think what they're really looking for is what I would call the state-like agency. And this is the, and then we come to the issue, incredibly important issue of international law. This is the so-called de facto Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Tiraspol. If you look carefully, my picture is not so good, but you can see that there are flags outside, which are only of other unrecognized places. So there's the flag of Abkhazia, South Ossetia, and Nagorno-Karabakh. There's this strange little club of unrecognized post-Soviet republics. They have their own football tournament, but you know, they interact with each other in a way that they don't interact with the outside world. But they're all very different. And this brings us to an interesting, almost philosophical question about what is a state. And I think, again, I've already touched on this. A state, I think, is a place in which there is some degree of internal sovereignty, which you find in all these places. So this is why I use the term state. And then there's another incredibly important issue. Can there be such a thing as creeping recognition? Is it possible that if we interact more with these places, that if we work with the local authorities, we are step by step giving these places some kind of recognition? This is obviously an important issue. And having studied the international legal literature on this, I think there's a fairly firm conclusion that there is creeping recognition is not a legal concept, it's a political concept. It's not possible to recognize a place by accident, even if by mistake an ambassador goes to Sokoli and shakes hands with the president, or even signs a letter with the president. It's not an act of recognition. Recognition is a very conscious political act. And I think this should be reassuring to the government of Georgia and other governments that it's possible, I think, to do much more within this framework of non-recognition. I see no prospect of recognition of these places internationally, and certainly not creeping recognition. And then we have the dilemmas about when we're talking about interaction with them. To what extent do you coordinate with the parent state? In this case, in the case of Abkhazia and Georgia, if you're an international actor, obviously very closely. Very closely, I would argue, but not completely 100%. If you read closely the latest European neighborhood policy, for example, the review, there's a line about how the conflicts in the post-Soviet space are a threat to regional security. But it's not just, they're a bigger issue than just for Georgia or Moldova, indeed Ukraine. That you coordinate, of course, with the parent state, but I think it's important for international actors such as the EU and the United States to understand that they have their own intrinsic agenda for these conflict zones. Secondly, the second dilemma is about working with the de facto authorities. This is an extremely difficult issue, but I think the answer is on a case-by-case basis, this you do need to work with the de facto authorities. It's not enough just to work with civil society. If you're working in any sector, there are people who are running schemes, whether it be in environment or health or education. So you can, to a certain extent, on a case-by-case basis, I think it is important to work with the de facto authorities. We can talk about that a little more. Third issue is about capacity building. This is a third, again, a dilemma. If you are funding projects there, to what extent you're building capacity, therefore, are you therefore strengthening the separatism of these places? Well, I think my conclusion on this is that these places have existed for so long that indeed you are building capacity, but I think there's a bigger problem perhaps, which is that they are losing their capacity by being integrated with Russia or with Turkey. And I think on a case-by-case basis, capacity building I think can be useful, particularly in terms of particularly I think in education and health sectors. I think no one wins by in these places have poor healthcare and poor education. So I think, again, capacity on itself on a case-by-case basis, I certainly would be advocate against any capacity building in government and security sectors. And I think the final dilemma is about confrontation with the patron. And this, obviously, this is not such a problem in Cyprus or in Transnistria, where there is quite a lot of international engagement. But certainly in Abkhazia, there's definitely a question mark about if you engage more, whether you come into a confrontation with Moscow. And I think the answer is yes, you will. You will certainly be challenged by Moscow. But then I would also say that not much is being tried at the moment, and it's worth trying a bit more and seeing what the reaction is. And possibly there will be areas where Moscow will not object to more international engagement. So let me. Here we are in Sokomi on the embankment. Hotel Ritza down in the distance. That's a picture of Vladislav Arzba on the wall. And here we'll talk about Abkhazia in the discussion. One sort of two-word description of Abkhazia is a stable isolation, a place that is not going to be recognized, but is also fairly stable and not about to collapse. And then I think the paradox since 2008, since Russian recognition, is that it's both materially better off since 2008, so there's been much more investment there, much more money into the economy, and yet greater international isolation. The international organizations have left. We've seen last year closing of crossing points on the Uri. We've seen problems with the Guardian population. So we have this funny situation of Abkhazia being both stable and isolated. And I think this indeed is a huge problem here in Tbilisi and internationally about what to do. Particularly when we come across, I think, this question here, which is self-isolation. The fact that I think more could be done in Abkhazia, but often the Abkhazia authorities themselves reject initiatives which they think have some kind of Georgian fingerprint on, and this can be a problem. So there's this phenomenon also of self-isolation. But it's interesting to contrast with Transnistria. This is the House of the Soviets, the Dom Sovietov in Tiraspol, with the statue of Lenin outside. And this is the kind of traditional picture you might get of Transnistria as a place which people think of as a kind of Soviet nostalgia theme park, very pro-Russian. But that's, if you haven't been following it very closely, in fact, in the last couple of years, there's been a lot of incremental progress. There have been a package of aid measures between Tiraspol and Chisinau, six of which have now been agreed on issues like license plates, diplomas, telecommunications, schools, and so on. And I think there's been a rather quite successful policy outreach by the European Union towards Transnistria. Transnistria has joined the European DCFTA, free trade agreement. And this is a quote by one former Transnistrian official to me. He said, "My head is in Russia, but my legs walk to Europe." It still feels very much in the Russian here, the Russian world in Transnistria, but in terms of the economy and trade, there's more and more connections with Europe. Well, about two-thirds of trade from Transnistria now goes towards Moldova and towards the European Union. Clearly, geography is much more favourable. Also, this conflict was much less traumatic than the Abkhazian conflict. But I think there's also a lesson here about keeping connections open, that in the 1990s, connections were not broken between Transnistria and the rest of Moldova, particularly economic links. And I think Unfortunately, our first year, the problem was that our children will be sitting and discuss this about how I think most of the mistakes in Abkhazia were made in the 1990s when links were cut, and it's very much easier to burn a bridge than to rebuild a bridge. In the 1990s, economic links, communication links were cut with Abkhazia, and then Russia came in, I think, in the 2000s and exploited that situation. Transnistria, the links were kept open, the connections were kept open, and now there's a more favourable atmosphere, a more pragmatic government in Tiraspol. We're seeing a lot of progress. Cyprus is an even older example, and it's in a very curious situation that the island has been divided since 1974, since the Turkish invasion, military intervention in 1974. And yet, in 2004, the whole of Cyprus formally joined the EU, but the northern part, the acquis communautaire, the European legislation, is suspended. And so the question in Cyprus is how to proceed, given that the northern part is part of the EU, but also heavily connected to Turkey. And it's quite frustrating, I think, to visit Cyprus, because you see many connections between the two sides, you see many people-to-people contacts, and yet still this unresolved conflict. But I think, again, interesting lessons about how a more open policy, more open engagement with Northern Cyprus has had positive results. The Green Line was opened in 2003, which meant that people, Greek Cypriots, could cross, and Turkish Cypriots could go south, Greek Cypriots could go north, they could visit other villages. There were predictions there would be violence, there was actually no violence. And this is an interesting lesson I should tell the Abkhaz about this, that, you know, with the passing of time, you should be letting Georgians come back on an individual basis to visit family cemeteries and so on. Because I think this has built up trust. And there's also tourism sector now in Northern Cyprus. It's much more open internationally. And instead of strengthening the kind of independence project, it actually weakened the independence project. There are now, I think, fewer Northern Cypriots want to be independent, and they consistently are more pro-European in the north of Cyprus, according to opinion polls, than in the south. But the conflict, unfortunately, is still unresolved. Let me just, I just have a section in Ukraine in this report. I won't really stop on that, just to say that, to remark that a conflict there is ongoing, people are dying, but I think the dynamics there are very much very different. The eastern Ukrainian little territories, the DN, so-called DNR and LNR, are much more artificial creations by Moscow. They have less local roots than the other conflicts. And the people there are constantly trying to cross this line. Tens of thousands of people a day cross the line of contact between government-controlled Ukrainian territory and the non-government-controlled areas. Sadly, I think Ukrainian government, when I say this in Kiev, not just in Tbilisi, is repeating some of the mistakes of Georgia in the 1990s, particularly the economic blockade is beginning to cut links between the two sides. The fear is that the temporary could start to become permanent in eastern Ukraine, and I hope that more Georgians will engage the Ukrainians in conversations about the state made in Abkhazia. Finally, this is around a policy report. My Swedish colleagues were keen to get some policy recommendations, and here I think talking about sectors where more can be done, more engagement. This is a picture of Abu, the University of Tsukumi, English language week. When I went out to speak to the students, I was expecting to talk in Russian to the people in the international international relations department, I found these young students who were quite happy to talk to me for an hour and a half, entirely in English. Their English was really not bad. They spoke English, and they were having English language week, completely self-organized, no international assistance whatsoever. Shows that there is a desire there amongst the student body to learn English, to reach out to the outside world. And then the question is, you know, we the outside world, but they're in Europe, you know, what are we going to do to help them? You know, surely providing assistance with English language teaching to support the university should be an easy thing to achieve, one would hope, and yet somehow it's not been possible so far. So there's a challenge, and not only in supporting in Tiraspol as well. But when I had a meeting in Tiraspol, we spoke in Russian, Sokolin beat Tiraspol when it came to English language. Healthcare, there are enormous problems in Abkhazia with healthcare, with hepatitis and so on. I think this is a sector where they do need international assistance and where that assistance can be provided not just by the healthcare provider in Georgia, which is certainly welcome, but also by some projects inside Abkhazia. In the environment, there are many environmental problems which cross the borders, such as the well-known stink bug, which has been killing hazelnut crop, and other problems, pollution, black sea, and so on, which I think would be beneficial to both sides. Travel is obviously a huge problem. Many people have been trying to solve that issue. I don't pretend I have an answer to that. What could the Georgian side get in return for this kind of assistance? Well, I think for one thing, this should be extended to very strongly to people of Gali. I think people of Gali are suffering, and I think people of Gali need to be very much made part of this. But also, I think in general, to empower constituency students like this can only be a positive thing. It makes Abkhazia more open to the world, more open to discussions both with Europeans and also with Georgians. I'm going to skip this. This was, you'll see this in the report. This is about Cyprus and about how dilemmas of engaging with authorities about and how the US Department of State is kind of twisting itself in knots about recommending that a parliament that doesn't recognize past legislation it doesn't recognize to solve a real problem. And I think this sums up, I think, the problem. There's a real human trafficking problem in Cyprus, and the US Department of State is recommending that the local government in northern Cyprus, which doesn't recognize past legislation to tackle it, and we will see some contradictions there. And I just leave you with this. This to me is rather a poignant image. Every time I go to Abkhazia and walk across the bridge, and some people walk and some people go on a horse and cart, and just the fact that there is a border, it's an artificial border, but it's still a border in ADL, to be technically correct, where people are either walking or using a horse and cart to cross the border, I think something is wrong here. Something needs to be fixed. And obviously it gets harder with passing time. There have been many missed opportunities. But I think, it's still important to think creatively about this, not to surrender to the status quo, and to think about ways of building better connections across this dividing line, not only between Samogrill and Abkhazia, but with Transnistria and Cyprus and Ukraine as well. So I'll stop here and hand over to our children.
Thank you, Tom. I believe the audience would like to hear some more of your observations about Abkhazia specifically, but I believe we'll make it up during the discussion. So, actually, now it's time for your intervention.
Thank you, Tom. recent work, which he is presented now. We are enjoying making ourselves familiar with his new work and findings. When Tom approached me with the request to be a discussant at this event, by the time I already had read his piece, because someone forwarded me a few days before, and I immediately found this report very interesting, and actually I read it in minutes time, because it was so much well-written and but most importantly touching a very topical issue which has been around already many years since Georgia, as well as Moldova, Cyprus, now Ukraine, suffering these territorial disputes within their borders. I will make a few comments and then I'll move to my observations regarding this report. Of course, I would like to know that I fully share most of the messages and most of the findings which Tom has in his book. He may not be able to provide us all of them during this short presentation, because they relate these messages relate to the issues which my colleagues here in Georgia have brought, including Tom, have been dealing with quite some time already, Tom and I had more than once the opportunity to discuss, to exchange views and discuss these issues, and I'm glad that this exchange has made some even modest contribution to this report. Also, I would like to make note that I always appreciate the comparative analysis, comparative studies, especially if the objects of comparison are correctly and rightly selected. Transnistria and Cyprus cases are quite relevant for comparison with the Abkhaz conflict. Less so, I would say, about Ukraine, because in Eastern Ukraine, the conflict is in the initial phase of development, and there is less interesting developments which could serve for us lessons for our future work. But of course, whatever we have lessons learned, all three, the case in Georgia, Moldova, and Cyprus, could be interesting for Ukraine. Since we are very much constrained in time, I would, with your permission, skip in my discussion Eastern Ukraine, and mostly focus on Transnistria and Cyprus, as I said, as they were very, very relevant cases for our situation. In his report, Tom has found many interesting facts, arguments, and his very interesting observations. He has a very unique, privilege, advantage compared to us, because he can travel. Guidelines, and with his own eyes can observe the developments here, talk to people, have the very, very interesting information. So that's, of course, something which makes his work, his findings, his analysis incredible. So I read for myself a lot of interesting in this report, and for myself I made a table of two factors, both contributing factors to compromise and obstructing factors to compromise in all three cases: Abkhazia, Transnistria, and Cyprus. And I found that there is an obvious we have an Austria, and on his side, this conflict has moved from the real moon violence into politics and law. In our case, we are unfortunately still stuck in a situation where we still face frequent cases of violence. And I will not spare time by naming each of these cases. We don't have here Geneva Convention discussions. We have IPRM as an instrument to discuss mutual complaints on violating the regime of stability on the ABL. We have a lot of available cases which makes our situation less favorable in comparison with the situation in Austria and Cyprus. In terms of obstructing factors, one important factor which Tom focuses attention is that in the Kazakhstan case, unlike Transnistria and Cyprus, we have ethnic dimension of conflict, which is absent there. Also, image of enemy towards parent state is very strongly visible and present in our case, while this is absent in Transnistria and Cyprus. And also the patron state, he touched upon this issue as well. Patron state's role in all these three cases are different. As Tom mentioned, in Cyprus, where Turkey has deployed 40,000 troops and occupies quite a sizable part of this island, still this patron state has a developed agenda vis-a-vis territory, while in Abkhazia as vice versa, the goals is absolutely different. Russia pursues geopolitical goal there, and that makes him a very destructive actor in terms of search for compromise in Georgian class confrontation. Not to go through all of these factors, you can find it in the book, in the report yourself. The bottom line here is that the two situations, the conflict situations, is Transnistria and Cyprus, these situations are transformed already, while in case of Abkhazia, we are still in the face of sharp antagonism and frequent cases of violence. And that makes the case in Abkhazia lagging far behind these two countries. That's why I would like to make this as one of the major points of mine, that we have to refocus our efforts on more pragmatic, more feasible, attainable goals, rather than pursuing the same goals as the transformed conflict parties can pursue. And I'll elaborate more on this in a second. So there are four most striking differences between Abkhazia on one hand and Transnistria and Cyprus. First is that, unlike the cases in Transnistria and Cyprus, the Georgian Abkhazia conflict is still in the phase of part of antagonism, as I already mentioned. The second is that there is an ethnic dimension in Georgian Abkhaz confrontation. Third is that, unlike Transnistria Cyprus, the Abkhazia fear against parent state, that is, Georgian state, and it bears existential, this is the threat of fear, bears existential character, which is also very significant. Abkhazians have always been scared by the rising, by the strengthening in Georgian state, especially since the war, when Georgia by strengthening institutions becoming more popular, more pronounced reformer in the world. But in the meantime, trying to coerce over Abkhazia and exercise increasing pressure. And the fourth point, here that position in Cyprus. Russia, as a petrol state, plays a more destructive role, I already mentioned this. So these 4 points make the situation in the Abkhazia case very unfavorable, and I think here we have to change attitude towards the policies which we all, both Georgian government, international actors, our partners, international organizations, individual governments pursue. We all are hostage of a situation where the parties to the conflict they fight for each other's red lines, and their attitude towards conflict resolution is a zero-sum approach. So at the expense of the other side to achieve whatever you want, and the national projects of the size of the conflict are absolutely different. One side aspires to the full independence, while the other side the territorial integrity. And to reconcile these differences within this paradigm of zero-sum approach, within this paradigm of conflict resolution, which is different and understood in Soviet Tbilisi, is very difficult, if not impossible.
Thank you, John. Now, before collecting questions from the audience, as a moderator, I'd like to ask you one question. I should say, is there only a breakaway region from cases where ethnic cleansing has taken place, at least in this case? Don't you make this place, this case, unique in a way? I mean, I want to say that the Georgian government has made a lot of good gestures towards the Abkhazian. Don't you agree? Despite the fact of ethnic cleansing. I absolutely agree with you that if nothing changes, then Abkhazia will be absorbed by Russia. That's something that no one wants much. Maybe the Abkhazians want it at the end of the day. If they didn't want it, maybe they would be much more active, much more open toward this. Don't you agree?
Well, as regards
ethnic cleansing, we should say that in Cyprus, actually, there was a similar number, around 200,000 Greek Cypriots, also left northern part, were ethnically cleansed, expelled from northern Cyprus, and also many, of course, there was a reverse process of Turk Cypriots also leaving the south. So we did see in 1974 a similar kind of traumatic cleansing of populations and dispersals of populations in Cyprus, although it happened on both sides. Absolutely, I mean, I understand that this is a major factor, that the kind of trauma that Georgia was living with this mass displacement in 1993. But let's also remember that the trauma happened on both sides, that you know, the Abkhaz won the war, in quotation marks, but it was a very, very bitter victory. The place was destroyed, and ethnic Abkhaz probably lost about 5% of their population in the war. It's a very small community and a very, very high casualty. So also very, very deeply traumatic for the Abkhaz. So I think, you know, this is beyond the scope of this report and this project. You know, certainly, for there to be reconciliation, there needs to be a lot of groundwork. Projects being done this on acknowledging what happened in the war, kind of memory projects, and then looking at the future of some kind of justice projects. I absolutely agree. This has to be a part of a solution. Do the Abkhaz want to engage with Georgia? I think the answer is a bit more complicated once you're there. I think there's a bit of a taboo about dealing with Georgians, but some people like to do it quietly. They go to get healthcare in Tbilisi, they go to a football match in Tbilisi. So I think if there were trade was to reopen, I think we would see quite a lot of people being ready to go back and forth between Abkhazia and the rest of Georgia. So I think there are possibilities. I do believe that the temperature of the conflict is still higher than in the other places, but it's gone down over the last 20 years, and I think is a result of much more reasonable messaging from the Georgian side. It's hard to look at Tbilisi now and to see a threat, from particularly in the last time since 2000. 2012. So I do see possibilities there. I also see other parts of the population, particularly the Armenians, who we just don't really know what they think, and they don't get a chance to talk in public. And I think they would certainly welcome, I think, a more open border, which would be a possibility to open transit through Georgia to Armenia, for example. So I think there is more material there to work with than meets the eye. It isn't a place where everyone is burning with memories of the war, particularly the younger generation. I think quite right.
Thank you. I believe everyone would like to travel to Brazil, but not everyone has this privilege, you know. Now let's collect questions from the audience, please. And then please introduce yourself and be specific. Please be specific.
Hi, my name is Timur Kiburaz, I'm a journalist. My question is probably to both Mr. Deval and Mr. Gigashidze. Mr. Deval, you have mentioned Transnistria and the fact that two-thirds of Transnistrian produce is sold in Europe through Moldova. In case of Abkhazia, as you know, up to 70% of Abkhazian budget is financed by Russia. There are signs that this financial aid is actually decreasing. I want to ask you, because you're traveling to Abkhazia, like you have insight. Is Abkhazian community, like political elites especially, are they worried about this process? And a question to Mr. Gegeshidze, or maybe to you as well. Does this open a door for the opportunity for Georgia to offer something more here? Is there a possibility? Or maybe to some international organizations? Thank you so much.
Or rather, in capacity of old-time friend of Tom's. I think that European policy of non-recognition and engagement is a reasonable policy in this situation, though the first component of this policy is simpler, let's say so, and non-recognition works more efficiently than engagement. No need to say that I strongly support the notion of the engagement, because after all, it would be easier for Georgia to deal with Europeanized, modernized Abkhazian society than isolated or crucified Abkhazian society. But, don't you read that they exercise internal sovereignty? In this case, and they exercise real control over their own territories. If Suhumi exercises internal sovereignty and wishes to be engaged with the EU to a greater extent, why do they not let UMM undertake activities on Abkhazian soil? And do you consider it possible to open EU's liaison office, as you put it, in Suhumi, while EU officers from EUMM are denied entry to Abkhazia? This is the first question. The second one. You say that enhanced engagement should improve the lives of ordinary people in the de facto states. Yes, it should. But you write that Georgians living in Gabi region, they are in many ways second-class citizens, I quote you. And modern-day Abkhazia is not yet in daily life, but is an ethnocracy in its politics, I quote you. So how could EU engage in better way, having in consideration this situation, severely oppressed Georgia? Just to make blind eyes, or what's the way? And the third and the last, again I quote you, that the EU would frame its response to elections in Abkhazia or South Ossetia as it does those in Cyprus by welcoming the choosing of a leader of Abkhaz community, and so on. I agree with you that elections in Abkhazia are better than in some recognized post-Soviet states. I do agree. But according, and this year is the year of the elections of the president in Abkhazia. But according to the Article 49 of the Abkhaz Constitution, only person of Abkhaz nationality or ethnicity may be elected as the president of Abkhazia. It means that the majority of population of Abkhazia are out of the game. They are out of the elections because they are unable to nominate their candidate in the elections. So how do you see European leaders who congratulate the leader, not of Abkhazia, but the leader of ethnic Abkhaz with the victory in this kind of elections? Well, what I learned, you see, from the experience of my country, that there should be conditionality. Where there was no conditionality regarding Georgia, it was counterproductive. And same would be in all other places. Thank you.
Tkentu zert tkentzitshe mistau bazero galis kartu mosaprioba da mala shudes ara ubeba istau mosaprotar enaz shobrioli mazeta abkhazetis okupatsis smere da svatsos ik samokupatsio khelisupeba atarebs kursifikatsis politikas da bavshebis tavloben skolebshe uzulenas ამის გამო ახალგაზრდა ტოვებენ გალს და ახალი ტალღა წამოვიდა დებილების აფხაზეთიდან. და მივიანებდა ჩემი სამხედრო ეს მიდოდა მეტყვა, რომ აფხაზეთში არ არკვლება სხვა ეროვნების არჩევნებში მონაწილეობას, სამხედრო არჩევნებში.
Much more detailed report on trade issues in Abkhazia. And I do think it's worth exploring that issue of, you know, expanding cross-country trade, and I think that's part of the step to a better future policy. I think has that in mind. Hopefully that will be mending the door of occupied territories to allow more economic activity. It would be much more difficult, absolutely, than in Transnistria for geographical reasons and historical reasons, but I do believe that there is definitely a business incentive, in part because, as you mentioned, Russian assistance to Abkhazia is being reduced. So I do believe that that should definitely be explored.
Is there any readiness within political
elites? Is there readiness? I think it depends who you talk to. I think there's readiness within the business community, but if you talk to the politicians, they give you a very standard political reply, which suggested to me that you need to have quite a lot of readiness and quite a detailed plan to put, that just talking about it in the abstract you get political replies. But if there's a concrete business plan, then I think there will be plenty of people in that house in this
school. Yes, I also agree on what you said. This really opens up opportunities for the sides to at least try to interact more with each other. Very favorable background is being laid by a successful program providing free healthcare services to the Abkhaz. It started very strongly in 2010 and 2011, but now tens of thousands of Abkhaz have received treatment, and of course this information is spread around Abkhazia. It works for opening up more opportunities for other initiatives, and these other initiatives are already appearing, and it is a step towards a better future, which has two components: trade facilitation and providing educational opportunities for the residents of Abkhazia. I think it has a future, maybe not an easy future, but still has some future at least.
there's a question whether or not the Russians will allow that initiative gets going in full fashion. And, I mean, there is no clear question on that, of course. One needs to wait and see. But given the Russia's behavior in Transnistria, where the country is already transformed, and Russia is not preventing the sides from additional interaction and enhancing their relationship, it leads me, at least me personally, to the conclusion that here as well, at least. Within the phase of transformation of the conflict, Russia may not be really a disruptive force. Maybe it will be getting to the real solution of the conflict, then Russia may be happy to do. Within the phase of transformation, Russia, I think, will not be the game spoiler.
How are you getting?
Okay. Julian, thank you for your questions. Yes, when Abkhazia can exercise internal sovereignty and self-government, but that does not include in security and defense issues. And clearly there is a veto on the EU amendment, which comes, I think, as much from Moscow as from Sukhoti. I agree, and I don't believe that veto, unfortunately, will be lifted. Conditionality. I actually agree with you on conditionality, but I say that there should be an EU, advocating EU presence in Abkhazia. I say that it should be on a give and take basis, that it should be offering more to the Abkhaz, but also demanding more from them. And I specifically mentioned the issue of demanding more from them on the issue of rights of Gali citizens, which I think is absolutely important in this. Also, the gentleman from Sukhoi, that this is very much answering your question as well, and absolutely that international assistance should be very much framed also within offering more to citizens of Gali and ensuring that their rights are improved. And the other issue which I think is important is the issue of impunity. The if I'm getting the pronunciation right, the old Khazorian case, the man murdered on the border. I think that if you have more contact, then you can demand more things such as justice and the issue of that man who was murdered. So I think I'm in favour of both conditionality and give and take. You're quite right, also both of you, that only an ethnic Abkhaz can stand in the election, although of course the whole population can vote for that candidate. I'm not really making a recommendation here, I'm just pointing out the contradiction with the Cyprus issue, that when there is that the leader of the Turkish Cypriots gets to travel to Europe and to Washington, is welcomed as the leader of the Turkish Cypriot community. And so I'm asking a question really about, is it possible in some circumstances to welcome or to interact with the leader of the ethnic Abkhaz community in a parallel way? I think the power of precedent means that that's unlikely to happen. But I think if that was to happen, that possibly there could be ways of getting better leverage. Demanding more from the de facto Abkhaz protest.
Thank you, and I believe gentlemen from the third row have a question or structure.
Question about engagement with the patron state. You said, Tom, that you see much more can be done. What are your recommendations specifically in this respect? How you can engage more international actors with Russia in terms of these post-Soviet conflicts. I think it's very prominent issue was, and I think if you look at Archer's previous writing, you can also see that that the EU engagement with Russia is an important element of overall and the framing for resolving this conflict. And just one comment, I'm not fully kind of agree with your premise that Russia doesn't play a developmental role in Vietnam housing. Yeah. Like 70% of the budget. If you visit some of the new, for example, electricity substation in Gagra, or some of the innovative schools in Suhumi, we can discuss and argue about the effectiveness of these projects, but obviously it's, I don't think you have a very strong ground kind of arguing that Turkey does much more, unless you have better evidence.
You have such stimulating conversations in large groups like this, and the materials build on and go forward. These are very difficult questions, and it's very helpful to have this kind of conversation. I think the dilemmas we face, as well as the importance of engagement and further engagement, have been very clearly elaborated, right through, of course, to the very painful issues that we also hear about. I'll limit myself to just mentioning that, of course, this opportunity that non-recognition and engagement policy offers us has been in practice for a long time, and we have indeed used the opportunities available to us to work particularly in the direction of education, environment, but also in areas of humanitarian, basic humanitarian issues. So of course, the concepts that have been raised by Adrian and others have been very much part of the focus, as well as the various other fora that we're engaged in, whether that's the political framework and so on. Tom, I think your outline of the dilemmas is very clear, but I just wanted to add one or two others for the thought. One is the importance of the humanitarian agenda, which I think our colleagues in the UN have a lot more to say. This is a very key area for us to think about. It's not only about what the political ramifications of our engagement would be, but it's also supporting Georgia and also in terms of our own focus to support, at least to a basic level, every citizen of Georgia. So this is the ongoing negotiation with Tbilisi here, as well as focusing on the EU's own security and non-recognition engagement policy. But I also want to just mention the need for the development, which in all the long years that I've been here, I'm very personal, if you don't mind, to suggest that there still is a long way to go in terms of common language. It's delightful to see the progress in the European languages, and I think this is something that the APA is particularly very interested in. But I'm also talking about the political language. Archie was talking about the general political framework, the difficulties we have. I would even go as far as saying which conflicts are we talking about, where are the frameworks to deal with that. In that context, how can the APAs and Georgians together find a common language on which to build understanding in all of this drama that's going on around them in order to move forward on these areas we've talked about? The other big dilemma is touched upon already. I think Olaf has started to mention it. How do we continue and deepen our engagement in a way that does not contribute to the concern of normalizing the presence of Russia or the influence of Russia in the area? This has got to be also something to take on board in the context also of, as you mentioned, the concern about creeping recognition. Is that a real thing? Or is it a perception? As long as it remains a perception, it is an issue that needs to be focused on as well. And so my question would be, how do we continue, which I think is very clearly the commitment to continue with engagement and to engage not only on the humanitarian level, but also with a focus on conflict transformation, indeed working towards conflict resolution. But how do we do this to trying to also not add an increased concern about that particular issue.
Well, thank you very much. My name is Shota Mukeshvili. I work for the Nobel Foundation. Well, I think it needs to be stated for the record that the role of Russia, I don't see any role but negative for the Russia. I don't think Russia is playing a non-destructive role. We never play a non-destructive in any form of conflict. Mitigation, transformation, reconciliation, and so on. So we should keep a very sharp eye on what the main problem is. But that's just for the record. Another thing is that I fully agree that the engagement is the only way forward. What I disagree with is that Georgian government can be sidelined in this engagement and the EU can do it without Georgian government. Because this is a non-starter. This is not going to work. But I don't think it makes sense to discuss this. Because, well, international community has done so many projects in Abkhazia and it has so little to show. While the Georgian government's program maybe it was not a game changer, but it was something that certainly left a long-term trace. So I think rather than EU or international network standing in Georgia government or the country of Georgia, it should engage Georgia first and have a much more coordinated approach. Otherwise, again, it's a monster. Thank you.
Russia certainly does have. Russia has certainly invested a lot in Abkhazia over the last few years, so I would say, yes, it's incorrect to say that it doesn't have a development agenda, it's got a lot of infrastructure and so on. I would say that, I guess the biggest difference I've noticed with Cyprus is that there isn't an emphasis on human capital, investment in human capital, and I think that's something that I see as a problem, actually, in general, in the South Caucasus, in Georgia, as well, and particularly in Abkhazia, this very, even a whole generation which has had poor schooling, poor higher education, poor professional training, and they're really within Abkhazia they're able to do things, but take them out of Abkhazia, and a lot of these people would really struggle, you know, to get a job in a European country, for example. So there's been very little investment in human capital. And you know, this is a multi-dimensional conflict. It clearly has a very strong geopolitical element. There needs to be a diplomatic element where you're dealing with Russia as well, and a local element as well as you're dealing with Abkhazia. I guess something about that I didn't really touch on, but I think it's worth exploring, is that Russia does have different agendas in this region. And you see this dilemma around the WTO, the World Trade Organization deal, brokered by the Swiss government on the trade corridors, which still hasn't been implemented, but has got close. And you see that there's quite a strong lobby in Russia which wants those trade corridors to open because it wants to do better business with Georgia and Armenia and sees the South Caucasus as a business opportunity and as a transit and communications opportunity. So there is this business lobby in Russia. And I think engagement with them can only be positive. I think, you know, more tomatoes a Georgian farmer can sell to the Russian market, the better. And if those tomatoes can go through a trade corridor which is open 12 months of the year instead of just 7 or 8 months, that has to be positive. So I think clearly all types of interaction with Russia are problematic. But the more that one empowers those people in Russia, the more business perspective on this region, the more tourism perspective, I think the better. The problem we have in Abkhazia, and even more in South Ossetia, is that the people there are on the ground are the civilian keys. The people who are there are the security people from the FSB and so on. And I think they have a very different agenda. It's all about locking down, it's all about closing opportunities. So I see this struggle between the kind of the Russian vision of business opportunities in this region and this kind of Slovakian security agenda. And at the moment, yeah, the Slovakian are definitely winning. But you know, we've still got to carry on talking to the Russians, encouraging to work with them. Arthur's question is therefore is about normalizing the presence of Russia. Well, again, I think the more that you, it depends, again, where you're working. I think if you're working in areas where the outcomes domestically are stronger, whether it might be in healthcare or environment, then you are strengthening local capacity vis-a-vis Russia, and that has to be positive, as in for Georgia. But obviously, this question obviously hangs over all engagement with Russia. And Shorty, you talk, you used the phrase sideline of the Georgian government. I think you misunderstood me. I don't believe in sideline of the Georgian government. I very much welcome the latest initiatives on healthcare and so on. But purely at the given moment, there are certain things the Georgian government cannot do in Ankara. It cannot work directly, for example, Waal University, but internationals can. So I think the Georgian government can do as much as the Georgian government can do. The Georgian government should coordinate with international actors. Sometimes there are places that only the international actors can currently go in Abkhazia, and I think the Georgian government should sufficiently trust its Western friends that in these areas the disengagement serves not only the interests of Abkhazia, but of Georgia and so
on. Do you want to go back? Yeah. I'd like to reinforce the Tom's point on the necessity of stronger engagement of the international actors with the Abkhazia. And not only with the suicide, but the de facto authorities, because you cannot avoid them. If you really want to start any, whatever small business or whatever small project you intend to do there, you still need to get some kind of permission, some kind of support from them, and you have to deal with them. So that's one point. Second point is that there is a logic behind the concern of the Georgian side.
Just on this issue, I fully understand the concerns of the Georgian side about seeing international engagement in Abkhazia. But again, first of all, I get back to the issue that there are no good options really for Georgia. It's only about preventing things from getting worse in many ways and choosing from some. And this was the fairly bad options. But I think this is a better option. And secondly, I can bring back to the example of Cyprus, which was a very closed society in the 1990s, a very strong Turkish ideology. But then, when it started opening up to the world, there was international tourists there, trade. It's a much more part of the kind of global. Feels more part of the global marketplace than does Abkhazia. The effect it had was actually to change attitudes in a more positive reaction, in a more positive direction, such that in 2004, it was actually the Turkish Cypriots who were voting in favour of the deal in the Republic of Cyprus, not the other hand, it was the Greek Cypriots who voted against. So I think they were seeking some kind of recognition through statehood. Clearly, the factor of the EU was very strong. But I think Georgia's best hope in the future of some kind of integration with Abkhazia is through the Europeanization of Georgia on the one hand, and the keeping open of options in Abkhazia on the other through some kind of international engagement. It's a very distant prospect, but I think you see some modest signs of optimism from what happened in Cyprus, admittedly over decades or over years.
Thank you. Any more questions from the audience? Yes, let's collect one more. There's a trade relation, especially with the Abkhazia. I'm just wondering whether we're actually in a completely new situation this year, 2019.
2019 already, in a way that if you look at the Abkhaz Treaty Alliance and Partnership Treaty with Russia, you can see that according to this treaty, Abkhaz already finalized the integration of the Eurasian Economic Union. So all the economic side of Abkhazia, the trade side of Abkhazia, is already in line with, as of end of 2018, in line with the Eurasian Economic Union. And of course, as you know, for the European Union and Georgia, within the defense from this free trade agreement, this could pose problems, a more bigger problem than we actually think. Because as you know, from the EU side, as far as I know, I haven't followed it now for the last few years, but I think there is no actually new policy vis-à-vis the Eurasian Economic Union. There is no EU kind of clear-cut position vis-à-vis the Eurasian Economic Union. Should the EU have a relationship with it or not, or what kind of relationship and all that. And now, of course, because of Crimea, and the Crimea is inside the Eurasian Economic Union, outside the Eurasian Economic Union, it's also complicated as communications as well. For that reason, I'm just wondering that even the proposal of the trade, for example, we might see like, more complications than we think, because in theory, I guess, some parts would be kind of symbiosis of the Eurasian Economic Union and the Deepen Progress and Bigger Agreement. But as far as we know at the moment, there is no agreement on this kind of stuff, at least from the EU side of the area, I guess from the Eurasian Economic Union side as well. That's just a comment regarding the trade, potential trade projects, and I think vision for trade. Thank you.
And tangerines. So, again, one will need to start studying the details of those products. And clearly, there's for them to be traded within the DCFTA regime, they're going to need to meet phytosanitary standards, which is also an enormous ask about how that could be achieved. And this is a problem which is now appearing in Transnistria. So, yeah, I don't underestimate the problems. I think anyone who says that any of this is easy is obviously living in a different universe, but there are many, many problems. One can only, I think, for every 10 good ideas, maybe only one will work, but that's still not an argument against offering 10 ideas.
Yeah. Thank you, Colton, for this great question. Of course, this is a problem, this will be a problem, but there are always ways somehow to find holes in the existing regulations. Future efficiently into the European market, exporting their goods to Georgia or exporting the raw materials and processing here in Georgia, so that the final product is labeled as a product of Georgia. So there are many ways, individually.
Those publications, all of it.